Well, today's Old Testament reading continues the story of David and Bathsheba that began last week. It's tempting to say that it's the end of the story of David and Bathsheba, except it really isn't the end. In some ways, it's a new beginning in the life of King David. Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann calls this the pivotal turning point in the books of Samuel. This is the point where David the hero turns into a tragic figure. Let me remind you of the story so far. David is the king of Israel, and the land has blossomed under his leadership. He's gained all the perks of his position, power, wealth. According to the text, at least 6 wives, an unknown number of children. There are 19 sons actually named in the Bible, as well as a bunch of concubines that he inherited from Saul. But last week, we heard that David, although not yet an old man, no longer leads his men into battle. He stays home while others fight his enemies for him. One day, when up on the roof of his house, he catches sight of a woman doing her monthly purification ritual. It's Bathsheba, the wife of Uriah, one of David's great war heroes. Now, Bathsheba has sometimes been portrayed as a temptress, but the purification bath was a required ritual, and it was normally done on your house roof. So she wasn't actually doing anything wrong. David was spying on her. William Willimon notes how quickly the text tells us David acts upon his desires once he sees this beautiful woman. The text is quite clear about who instigates the events. He saw, he sent, he took, he lay. David has clearly become very used to the power that comes with being a king, and there's no wrestling with a conscience here. David is using his royal power to get what he wants. He's not in love with her. He just intends this as a simple night of pleasure. And I doubt if David takes either Bathsheba's or Uriah's wishes into consideration. But things don't turn out so simply. A few weeks later, Bathsheba sends a message to the king. Her simple words, "I am pregnant," shatter the king's world. David attempts to salvage the situation, but already control is slipping through his fingers. He tries to pass the child off as Uriah's own by bringing Uriah home from the war and attempting to get him, almost ordering him to sleep with his wife. But Uriah won't cooperate. So David takes the cover-up one step further and sends a message to his general Joab, ordering him to deliberately arrange for Uriah to be killed in battle, which Joab does. So David marries Bathsheba, and he probably thinks everything is now fine. But then another narrative enters this rather conventional story of power and its methods. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. David might be happy with how things turned out, but it turns out God isn't. At this point, we have a collision of two narratives, the story of how power is gained and used and inevitably abused in this world, and a second narrative about God's plans for the world. David may indeed be blinded by lust and power. He may think his power and position give him the right to do whatever he wants, but it isn't the whole story. David thought he was the only one of consequence in his story. But then God sends the prophet Nathan with a different narrative than the one that David is telling himself. Now, in Nathan's parable, the rich man is sketched in a rather flat way. He's rich and he has everything he wants, period. The poor man has a much more interesting description. Now, in David's version of how things work, the king is the center of the story, while nobodies like Bathsheba and Uriah are barely noticed. They're around to be used and abused at the king's will. But in the prophet's story, the tables are turned, and our attention is drawn towards the poor man and his beloved lamb. Like David, the rich man, being powerful and decisive, has the freedom to act. He sees, he takes, he consumes. But the parable is more than just an artistic means of ensnaring the king in his own blind arrogance. Rather, in laying the king's story and the prophet's story side by side, we are shown the collision of our story of personal power with God's story. When God speaks through Nathan, gift is the main topic. God reminds David of God's past graciousness. Everything David currently has, his position, his wealth, his family life, all have come as gift. David is reminded by God that what David thinks of as his own achievements are in reality given to him by God. Even though it was David fighting the battles that brought him to the throne, it was God who gave him the talents and abilities he used to do it. So God rightly asserts, I anointed you, I rescued you, I gave you, and furthermore, I would have added as much more. The thing that enrages God is how David has abused God's gifts. David's sin is revealed to be that of living as if he didn't belong to God, as if he didn't have to answer for how he used the gifts God entrusted to him. But to give David his due, despite having been seduced by the story of his own power, when Nathan holds the truth up, David submits himself to God's account of the way that things really are, and he repents and admits his wrongdoing. But there are still consequences to David's actions. Today's reading ends with David's confession, making it look like a happy ending. But despite David's repentance, much grief and death are still resulting from these actions. God's forgiveness doesn't mean our actions don't still have consequences. David is forgiven by God, but his action in taking Bathsheba creates divisions in his family that ultimately result in civil war and the death of many of his sons. So, what does all this mean for us? No one here has the kind of power and authority that David had. So even if we wanted to do what he did, and hopefully none of you do want to murder someone to get their wife or husband, we probably wouldn't be under the illusion that we would get away with it anyway. But we fool ourselves if we think that that means we don't have power, or that what we do or don't do doesn't have serious consequences, or that what we do isn't important enough to matter. At its most basic, power is simply the ability to do something, to influence people or events in some way. So while none of us has the power of a King David, we all do have power. At different levels, of course, depending on circumstances and the situation. But we have power. We all have the ability to choose to do one thing over another. We all influence the lives and actions of others in what we do and how we do it, in what we say and how we say it, in what we focus our time and energy on and what we don't, in what we spend our money on and what we don't. The question we face is, do we, like David did, make those decisions on the basis of our own ego desires, or do we ground our actions in God's love, in God's justice, in God's desire for abundant life for all God's children? As Paul reminds us in his letter to the Ephesians, we are part of God's ongoing story of love. Love is not some ideal we summon up through discipline and motivational hype, but the fruit of relationship. Specifically, the fruit of the relationship we have with our loving God. Love is expressed by using the gifts that God has given us in a way that honors the God who gave them. The result of this grounding of our actions in God is shalom, which we usually think of as meaning peace, and it does, but it means peace in the broadest sense. It's peace that comes from wholeness and justice and equity. Grounding ourselves in God's love doesn't mean we won't fail or that our failures won't have consequences for others as well as ourselves. But God is always willing to forgive us and bring us back into the story of redemption. Today's passages call us to live our life in relationship with God, a relationship in which love is celebrated and love is generated despite our inevitable failures.